Hi everyone, I'm Shaylin here with Readzy. Today let's talk about planning a series. So we're covering series this week. Today we're going to talk about the basics, all of the general stuff, how to plan a series no matter how many books or what structure it is. And on Friday we're going to cover the trilogy and how to structure a trilogy, since that's probably the most popular structure for a series of books. Before we get into that specific case though, today let's just look at series in general and talk about how to write one. So there's definitely quite a lot to consider when planning a series, probably a higher level of pre-planning than you'd need to expect for a standalone. So let's talk about some of that in this video and the things you should consider if you're setting out to write a series. Now the first thing you should ask yourself is, do you need to write a series? Does your story need to be a series? You want to write a series if it's the best option for your story, if the story simply can't be contained to one book. If the story could be contained to one book and you try to stretch it into a series, you'll end up with multiple weaker books when one book would have been stronger. A series requires long-term potential for deep character development. Readers will come to book one because of the concept, but they will come back for book two, book three, and beyond because of the characters. If there isn't a chance for significant character development, a pretty substantial character arc, the story is probably not worth spreading across multiple volumes. Readers need to get something new from the characters in every single book. This development needs to be palpable and it needs to be quite significant. Within some genres, notably science fiction and fantasy, no matter the age category, series is the norm. It is extremely rare to find a standalone fantasy novel. Genres like crime or mystery, romance, historical fiction, and contemporary can work as a series, but they can also work as a standalone. There are exceptions, but series are definitely not the norm for literary fiction. If you feel that your story has a large scope and that there are distinct arcs within the main story, you're probably looking at a series. The more timeline and the more point of view characters, the more likely it is that the book's scope has also extended beyond the boundaries of a standalone novel. So you've decided to write a series. Step one is to identify which type of series you are writing. There are three main types, but one is a little different, so we'll cover it last. The two main types that you'll see are episodic or procedural and serialized. These terms come from the TV world, so a procedural means that each individual installment is its own story. You see this structure in a lot of sitcoms, you see it in a lot of crime shows. Basically, every episode follows a similar structure, but each episode is its own story. On the other hand, we have serialized stories. This is the kind of thing that you usually see in a TV drama, like Game of Thrones or Breaking Bad. Basically, it's one really long story that has been cut into easily digestible pieces. You tend to see serialized fiction in fantasy, sci-fi, and historical fiction, whereas you tend to see procedural or episodic fiction in crime or mystery, as well as sometimes in middle grade. Now, some books are a little bit of both. For example, Harry Potter. In the early books, each book stands a little more on its own. There's a unique storyline and a unique arc to each book. However, there is still a main arc that spans the entire series, and that main arc starts to take over more and more the deeper we get into the story. Now, the third type of series is a little different, and it's interlinked standalones. Basically, this means that the books are in a series, but technically they're also all standalones. They probably all follow different characters. They're just linked by some factor. For example, set in the same world, the main characters of one book might be side characters in another. We're not really going to talk about this type of series in this video because it is much more so like just writing a bunch of standalone novels, and you don't need to plan for it the way that you would plan for a regular type of series where there's a much more overarching plot. Now, if you're writing an episodic series, the series could essentially go on forever. These kinds of series follow usually one central main character exploring a different conflict in each book. So let's say that you're writing a crime thriller series and it's a procedural series. So you have your main character who's a detective, and in every single book, he's got a different mystery to solve. You could essentially carry this trend on for 30 books if you wanted. Things become much more complicated the more serialized your story gets. So if you've decided to write a serialized series, which is very difficult to say, early on, you want to map out how many books you think you'll need to tell the story. Now, don't become too married to this number because it might change, but remember, you want to think about telling the story in the fewest books possible. A story stretched over too many books can lose a lot of momentum, and Every single book that you add, you're increasing the difficulty of writing the series an exponential amount. The series needs to be able to carry itself and have momentum for that much longer. So you want to think about the fewest number of books that you'll need to tell the story, and if possible, aim for that number. It's very common for series to drag because the author gave themselves too much space to play with it, and so they started to wander. So set your goal low and only add in a new book if you really need to, if you realize later that the story simply can't be contained in the number of books you're trying to write. Now, if you've decided to discovery write your series, well, congratulations, you can probably start now. Discovery writing a series is a feat, and even though I'm a discovery writer myself, I will tip my hat to anyone who can successfully discovery write an entire series without any prior planning, but if that is your process, you know, go forth and prosper. However, if you are trying to discovery write your series, I would say that you probably want to hold off trying to publish until you're a little further down the road. If you set into, say, a 5-book series with no prior planning, you just begin to write it, and you realize in book 3 a new idea strikes you, but you needed to set it up in book 1, but you've already published book 1, you could run yourself into a bit of trouble. So if you are discovery writing, I would say give yourself a lot of time, give yourself a lot of leeway in terms of publishing, maybe get midway into the series at least before you publish the first book so you don't end up with publishing regret. But let's say you do want to do a little bit of planning. You can outline the entire series, create a full series outline, and then write all the books. Or you can just outline and write one book at a time. Now, the benefit of outlining the entire series is, of course, you're unlikely to miss something that you needed to set up in an earlier book. You won't have unexpected delays between books, and you'll know exactly what you're working towards. The downside is that it's extremely doubtful that your story will stay set in stone over the course of writing it. I think it's probably highly unlikely that you could outline a 7-book series, and then in the years that it will take to get to book 7, not have some significant developments emerge while you're writing. A good medium between the two strategies is to make a loose outline of the entire series, and then do deeper outlining for each book as you write them. This will cut down on that very long process of outlining the entire series while still giving you a bit of direction. When doing your outline of the entire series, you want to identify the inciting incident and the climax for the series as a whole, as well as the inciting incident and the climax for each individual book. Not doing this before you write the first book could cause you major pacing issues for the series as a whole, and will help you make sure that you do have a solid arc for each individual book. That'll probably also be an indicator of how many books you need in the story. If you're trying to write 6 books, but you only have 5 inciting incidents with 5 climaxes to pair with them, the series is probably only 5 books long. Think of your series as a back and forth between wins and setbacks. So if one book ends on a win, the next book will probably begin with a setback. The deeper you get into a series, the more open-ended the books can be. The first book probably needs to stand on its own more than any other book in the series, but the longer the series gets, the more open-ended your endings can be. You might even end on a cliffhanger. That's unadvisable for the first book, but it's probably fine for the 4th book in your series. If your series is quite long, you also want to consider withholding certain characters, plot threads, or locations to introduce into later books. If you play all your cards right at the beginning, you'll have nothing new to add into the story to draw in reader attention and add a little momentum later on. Think about all the series you've read. It's pretty common to introduce a new character at the beginning of book 2 of a trilogy or throughout the middle of a longer series. This can pique the reader's interest and it can add a little bit of momentum into the story. You also want to remember as you're planning your series as well as writing it that you have so much time. You have so many books, so don't worry about introducing every piece of information at the start. I remember when I was trying to write a series, I felt like I needed to just make everything clear, the readers needed to know everything about my world within the first act of book 1. You know, I was setting out for a 5-book series. There was absolutely no reason why the readers needed to know the inner workings of every single aspect of my world within the first book. Sometimes it's best to hold back. You have multiple books to share all of the information you have. You don't need to pile it all into the first installment. So create a driving force of action and compelling characters before you start clarifying what the imports and exports of your fantasy kingdom are. Remember, the key to a series is evolution. Ideas presented in book one need to evolve into something more complex by the end of the last book. Elements of the story need to be more than they initially appear. Something that might seem simple or not integral to the story in the first book might become the key, or might evolve into something very complex later in the series. Same goes with characters. Even though you want your characters to be complex in book one, by the end of the series, you've had so much time to develop them that they should be able to reach a new level of complexity that the reader couldn't even anticipate. Now, it is common as the author to start running out of steam throughout the middle of a series. You are running a marathon, not a sprint. The middle of a book, just a standalone book, is notoriously hard to write, and the middle of a series is that amplified. When in doubt, make sure to keep ramping up the tension. This is probably one of the most difficult elements of a series, is that you need to continue to raise the tension for a very long period of time. If you feel like you're running out of steam, it's probably because you've resolved too many of the conflicts, so therefore you've lost stakes and you've lost tension. And finally, the more you plan, work on creating your series Bible. This is a place where you store every single piece of information that you have. Now, there's no one way that you need to organize it, but you probably want to break it up into sections based on character, world, subcategories within the world, plot, probably divided based on each book, maybe based on each storyline within that. And you can just store this on your computer, or you might even print it and create a giant actual series Bible. But basically, this is where you want to store everything, so that everything you need to know is in an easy to find place. Organize it in a way that makes most sense for you and is most accessible for you, so that you don't accidentally end up changing a character's name midway through the series. If you are setting out to write a series, it's likely that you were working on a fantasy series, so I'd recommend checking out our video on world building and our video on magic systems if that is the task that you are undertaking. So to summarize, before you start working on a series, make sure that it's the best format for the story. But consider that series are the norm for certain genres. Determine which type of series you're writing, whether it's serialized, episodic, or a set of interlinked standalones. Aim for as few books as possible at the start, and only add books if you realize that the story truly can't be contained within that number. How much you'd like to plan beforehand really is up to you, but it's probably advisable to have at least a general series outline before you start working on book one. Make sure your characters have the potential for long-term and significant development, and that you're able to evolve elements of the story into something more complex or unexpected. Remember, you have a lot of time, so you don't need to play all of your cards right away. Save some things to be introduced later. And if you feel like your story is running out of steam, it might be because you're running out of tension due to resolving some of the conflicts within your story. Try to keep ramping up the stakes and increasing the scope of the conflict. So that is how to plan a series. All the power to you if you are trying to write a series. It's no easy feat, but it's definitely a very worthwhile one. Thank you so much for watching, and remember to subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss any new videos from us. We've got new writing, editing, and publishing tips every Tuesday and Friday. Until next time.